Most useful watercolour colours. Now, most of my colours are made by Winsor & Newton. I use both the professional brand and also the student brand, or the Cotsman version. You find one has got more pigmentation with it, which is a professional version, and the Cotsman version, which is the student quality ones, got less pigmentation, a little bit more binder. So I do find I've got to replace those colours on a regular basis. So here are my best 10 colours for you to see. So let's make a start. Let's play with the colours, and I'll tell you a little bit about each one as I go along. Now, the first colour is Gamboge Hue. But look how dark it is in my half pan there. It's really dark, isn't it? But yet, when you mix it up and you thin it out, it gets nice and pale, very similar to lemon yellow, but a little bit warmer. It's actually got a little bit more of, I would say, burnt sienna in there. That's how it feels to me, you know? So it's a little bit browner in that. So let's get some mixed up first of all. So here we go. Now, because these are concentrated, so these obviously half pans, you do have to work them up. Right, that should be enough, hopefully. I'm going to use a size 8 brush. Now, this is a travel brush by Panart, which is that one there. Series 1111. There you go, it's a D-Ramble. Now, load the brush up, and we'll give this one a try, shall we? So let's start off around here. Yeah, that'll do. I'll just do a little bit of a kind of curve with it. But what I'm going to do with this, I'm going to wash that brush out now. Now, I've wasted all that paint. I'm going to load that up with some fresh water. I just weaken this down as I bring it down towards the bottom. And I want to show you the kind of gradual depth of tone that this has. Now, this is basic Gamboge Hue. Now, hue, as we know, is a colour. That's all it basically means, colour, doesn't it? Hue. However, it also means that this particular colour is synthetic. And it's quite a nice colour, as you can see. So you can just see that warmth in there, can't you? So you can see why I like this particular colour. So Gamboge Hue, as you know, not new Gamboge or just Gamboge. Gamboge Hue is a nice one to work with. And you find this particular one is a permanent paint, so it does stay on the paper quite well. And also it's transparent as well. So in other words, you can layer colours over the top of that and this will still show through a little bit. Now, Cadmium Orange, it's a very nice colour to work because I use this within a lot of fur paintings and feather paintings. So basically birds, so any kind of wildlife, even foxes, for example, I've used orange within a fox before because of that kind of red fur, isn't it? But this kind of brightens up the background as well. Now you find cadmium orange really is more of a permanent and can be opaque in nature. Obviously that depends whether it's student quality or professional quality because that can change the properties of the paint as well. So just bear that in mind when you're buying paint. But you can mix this with a variety of colours. Again, burnt sienna is a nice colour to mix with this. It really is, actually. A little bit of Scarlet Lake, or even burnt umber to dullen it down a little bit as well. So that's quite nice. So let's give this a quick try and see how we get on with that. So I'm going to load that brush up as well. I'm going to bring that now. Where should we start? Let's just start over here, shall we? I'll let that blend into that yellow that we've already got on there, even though it's just about dry on there. And then bring that down the same way I've just done the other one. Probably down to about somewhere like that. Give that brush a quick rinse out, and then we'll just soften this down and lighten that colour up a little bit as well. So you can just see how pale that can go. Look, isn't that lovely, isn't it? What a lovely colour. It's actually quite a warm orange as well, which is quite nice to use. So you can use this within a variety of projects. Scarlet Lake. Now that is a lovely bright colour, as you can see there. It really is. And I've used that for many of the paintings that I do. It comes in very handy. It really does. So let's pop that one in there just to begin with. I do find this works up really quickly as well, this particular one. Very nice to work with, as I say. But it's also one of those colours which is staining. So you can really stain the paper. So if you try lifting off paint, you will find that this particular colour is a bit tricky to lift off. And it might just leave a bit of a hue, a bit of a tint on that paper. It was hue anyway. Right, there we go. Let's give this one a quick try and see how well it performs. Right, so if I give this one, just load that one up a minute, and we'll try that one again. Here we go, you ready? Try this out. So just join that onto the orange. Why not? And then bring that down. Oh, look at that for a rich colour. Very rich indeed, isn't it? Just go to about there, that'll do. Rinse that brush out. Bring that down here. Oh, look at that. And then lift a little bit of paint off. Now, when you're lifting paint off, you can just take some paint off that brush, like so. Then lift a little bit more off. If you can just lighten that colour. Look how pale that is. A nice kind of warm pink, isn't it? It really is. Very nice indeed. And you can see why I like using this. And you can also tone this one down as well. If you want to just kind of dullen it down, use it as a background tone, background colour within paintings as well, which I've done many times before. And again, it's a colour I use on a regular basis when I'm working with my my wildlife paintings. A colour I like to use is Phthalo Blue. Now, Phthalo Blue is very vivid. It really is. I know it's such a bright colour. I'll just show you what I mean. So just get some mixed up in my mixing well here. Give that a quick try. Now, that's the one there. Highly concentrated, but easy to work up as well. Now, Phthalo Blue is a staining colour. And also, in this case, transparent. Really? Yeah, I know. So you really can use it as a layering colour as well. I very often use this particular colour when I'm working with something which is very bright, very vivid. So think of, say, a macaw parrot, and you've got those bright blues and colours within a macaw. This is really useful for something like that. And obviously you can mix this with other colours as well. So if you want, let's say, a nice green, this will make a lovely green to work with. I've used it many times for greens. Instead of just using the standard green, it's very handy for that. So make up a little bit more. Something like that will do. Nice and milky. Now people say to me, Paul, I haven't got Phthalo Blue. I've got one called Intense Blue. But that's the same colour, believe it or not, Intense Blue. Really? But also, it's the same colour as Windsor Blue. Windsor Blue. And also another one called Monastral Blue as well, which is quite a nice colour. Well, hang on, it's the same colour. Oh God, I don't know. What am I like? Let's just try this on the paper and you see what I mean, Mark. Just go into that red a bit, even though that's dried now. Try that down there. We'll give this one a blast. Look how bright that is. Such a rich blue, isn't it? It really is. And you can see why something like this would work really well. Look how that's gone purple in there, Mark. Just within that red. That's because, as we know, Phthalo Blue is transparent. So therefore, the red is showing through underneath. Really, really useful. So let's just take off a little bit of paint down the bottom here. Okay, lift it. All right, remember what I said, tissue. Then take some more off as well. So that's a lovely colour, but you can see why I like that one, Phthalo Blue. And it can get really intense with that. Look how dark I can go by tapping some fresh colour in the top. If I get really concentrated pigment and drop that in, you can see how well this particular colour works. Now, Purple Lake is another colour I like, and it's this one here, look. So I'm just going to grab my mixing palette and pop that in there in a minute. I've used this one for quite a lot of the animal portraits, but also botanical as well. Because you find Purple Lake is not just permanent, but it's also a transparent colour. And you can see how transparent that would be on the paper. It's a nice one to work with, actually. And you find also that it mixes really well when you want to get more of a kind of deeper tone with this colour. I mean, you can see how deep that tone goes. When you look at my half pan here, look. See how deep it is within that half pan. Very, very thick. So just pop that in there. Well, let's give this one a try and see how well it goes on the paper. Now, the paper I'm using today, by the way, I haven't mentioned this, is Bockingford. It's one I've used all the time for many, 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 many years. It's a lovely one to work with. It's sort of a medium range paper. So very nice indeed. Let's just drag that into that blue shell. Look at that. Oh, look at that. Oh, there it goes. Okay, grab some more. Okay. Make sure that's on screen for you. Then all the way down to here. Now, that's not very concentrated at the top there, is it? So what I might do, you know, is add a little bit of pigment back in there in a minute. Just lift that paint off there. Just so you can see the gradual variation of that tonal value within it. And then you add some more pigments in there. Look at that. Get some more. And drag that into that Phthalo Blue. And there you go. We can also see why this particular colour is one of my favourites. Oh, So lovely, isn't it? There we go. And that one is, as I said, Purple Lake. I mentioned the Purple Lake. You can see that lovely violet colour we got there now, look. I'm going to mix that with Phthalo Blue. Very nice, isn't it? Okay, so that's five done already. So I'm going to go for another one, which is going to be Olive Green. Alright, so that's that one there, look. And that is, again, a nice colour. I tend to use olive green a lot when I'm working with foliage. You know, if we're working on the stem of a plant or something like that. But I'll mix it with something. Either with, guess what, burnt sienna, which is quite a nice one to mix it with. Or a little bit of lemon yellow or Gamboge Hue. Anything like that. And if you add a little bit of yellow in there, and it gets lovely and pale. A bit like a leaf green as well, you know. So really nice to work with. And I find it's not too false. I mean, there are colours which we use. Things, for example, like Hooker's Green. I use it occasionally, just occasionally. But it's not, to me, it's not really kind of a natural sort of green, you know. And to be honest with you, very often, you might want to mix your own greens from different yellows and different blues. But this is one more of my kind of go-to colours when I'm working with a green. As I say, I'll probably add to it with a little bit of colour here and there as well. So this is more of a staining colour, which you tend to find. There you go. Something like that. But it's staining, but it can also be transparent. Again, it depends on the manufacturer. It depends on the quality of the paint. So a little bit of green. There we go. And you can see it's a nice, deep, rich green, isn't it, when you're working with olive green. But that's a lovely green, isn't it? And you can see how pale it can go when you get right down to the tip of there. So you can have that really watery if you wanted to, and just have just a hint, just a tiny hint of green within the paint. Okay, try and keep that wet a little bit longer, and let's go for the next colour. Now, burnt sienna, that's the next one I'm going to have a look at. Again, this is one of my go-to colours. And it's a very, very rich brown. Like a reddy brown, isn't it, burnt sienna? I've used this as a mixing colour with another colour for mixing two or three colours together, sometimes even four colours together. But I'll tell you what I've got, actually. When you work with browns, I've got a little video which you might be interested in watching. Here on YouTube, of course, and I'll put a little link to the top corner there for you to have a look at, okay? But you can watch that after you've watched this one, of course. Let's add this one in now. So starting from the top, branch it into the green. Let's see what colour that makes. Oh, look at that. That's a nice colour, actually, isn't it? Lovely colour. Reload, and then bring that down. Bring it down, bring it down to me, all the way down to there. There you go. But this gives you a general idea when you're just playing with the colours like this to kind of see how well they mix together. The kind of colours that you can make from them. And would you believe as well, I've done some research on this, by the way, that burnt sienna is one of those colours that's been found, because it's obviously made by earth colours, by basically natural minerals, it's been found in cave paintings. I know, burnt sienna, and that's this colour here. That's how old this particular colour is. Amazing, really, isn't it? So really, with burnt sienna, it's a nice bright brown. It really adds vibrancy, colour and warmth to a painting, so well worth having within your painting kit. And one I'll never do without. Now, burnt umber, and you find the reason why it's called burnt umber, the word burnt means that obviously burning the raw pigment intensifies this colour. So hence the name burnt umber, hence the name burnt sienna, and so on. Okay, burnt umber. Let's give this one a quick blast, shall we? So we'll start, oh, look at that. We'll start from the top. Oh, there it goes. And we'll bring that one down. Like that. Probably down to there. That'll do. That'll do. The brush will wash out again. And then with clean water, clean brush, start down the bottom there. And then get ready for this. There it goes. Catch it. Wait, catch it. There we go. But that's burnt umber. You can see how rich that is. And you can get this really dark as well. And the way to look at that as well, when you look at the half pans, look how dark it is around the edge here where it's concentrated. Yes, it's nice and wet in the middle. So therefore, it's a little bit more watery, a little bit brownier, as you can see. But really thick paint, such as that there, just try and drag some of that off. You can see, when I just dab it, look how dark that is. You know, it can make a nice rich dark colour from this colour as well by using that in conjunction with other colours like blue and red. You know, so it's a very nice one to work with actually. I do like working with burnt umber. Of which, of course, as I mentioned, I use in just about every one of my paintings. Well, nearly every one anyway. Now, lamp black is one of those pigments which has been used again for many, many years. So it's one of the oldest pigments still used today, believe it or not. You find the pure carbon pigment from lamp black is, well, it's made from, believe it or not, from soot, residual soot from burning oil. And that's, well, hence the name, lamp black. See what I mean? So that's how it's all kind of come around, really. It's made from soot. Would you believe that? Now, there's a lot of blacks on the market. We know there are. So what have you got? You've got lunar black. There's ivory black. There's a neutral tint. And each one performs in a different way. Each one has its own properties. So, for example, if you went for ivory black, you find it's more of a sort of browny black. If you went for this one, lamp black is more of a bluey black. Here we go. Now, lamp black. Let's give this one a go. Now you can see how dark that is. You can see why this particular black is kind of known or been used for many, many years. It's really deep black, isn't it? And this is one of the reasons why I like using it. I like the blue hint of it as well. I do like it having that blue side, that kind of blue bias. And it's really nice to know that's there to kind of work with. And I like the idea of having the blue because, well, you can either keep it cool or you can have a warm colour, you know the colours I mean, to that to kind of warm it up a little bit if you want to. But the good thing about lamp black as well is that you can make some nice greys from it. So if I just take some of that colour off there, look at that. So these are really cool greys. They can work with lamp black. So this is another reason, again, one of many reasons I like to use lamp black within my paintings. I know black is one of those things where not everybody wants to use black. They'd rather make their own version of black, which you can do. Red, yellow, blue, you know the colours. So you can do it that way around. There's different ways of making black as well, not just with red, yellow and blue. So, you know, I tend to find that working with black itself, as long as I add a colour to it, instead of using it on its own, then I find it works perfectly for the paintings that I do. But that's down to individual choice, it really is. And it depends if you want to be more traditional with your watercolours and prefer to mix your dark pigments or your dark colours up. But you can see that this works really, really well. And you can see again why it's within my selection of my favourite 10 colours. Now I'm going to paint some more black over here, and that's because I want to show you one more colour. Right, so bear with me a minute. I'll just get this onto the paper and I'll give it a quick dry as well. But I need some dark on there to be able to show the light. So what do I mean by that? What am I talking about? I'll show you in a minute. Now the last one is watercolour white. Now there's a lot of whites on the market as you can see here, look. So it depends on the opacity I find. And also, sometimes you get like a bit of a yellow hint or a yellow tint to the colour. So be careful when you're looking around watercolour whites. I do have a video on here, by the way, when I'm testing these white paints out. So have a look at that one. I'll pop a link to the top right-hand corner there for you. So have a look at the different white paints that you've got. Now, I know not everybody uses white paint, but this is one I always use, especially when I'm adding lots and lots of highlights, literally hundreds of lines for fine hairs, you know, within a pale animal. So it's really handy for that. And it just saves me kind of reserving the white of the paper as well. But you have to make sure, as I say, that that white paint is certainly opaque in nature. Now, if I get a little bit of water in there, just down there, look, just a small amount will do. And I'm going to get my size 00 brush, which is my main brush when I'm painting my video tutorials. Just make this more to a creamy consistency like that, though. Just got a nice bit of a tip on there, completely covered at the end of the ferrule there, but never mind. And you find when you're working with white paint, you really got to think about how thick that white is, and that's far too thick, far too thick. So I need to thin that down a little bit. And the thinner the paint, the easier that paint will flow, as you can see there, look. So it's starting to flow that little bit better. However, when you're working with white paint, you'll also find than the white paint. If it's too thin, we'll go quite pale. So that depends on where you're adding this into. We definitely need a darker background. Not necessarily black, but something like a mid-tone will be just enough waterfall for the white paint to stand out. So this is one of the reasons I use white paint, you know, to make a kind of highlights on in the middle of an eye or something like that with an animal portrait, or to simply add a few little sparkles here and there, or if I wanted to, very fine lines, such as that there. So that's why watercolour white is something I use, again, within most of my paintings. But you've got to make sure, as I mentioned, it's opaque. So have a look at the manufacturer's details before you buy that white paint and find out if it's opaque or not. Because if it's not opaque, you will find all you could do is just get some watery one there, like. You'll just fade as it dries. So you see what I mean? As that starts to dry in a bit, that'll get a little bit faded as it dries. And if I get more of a creamy consistency instead, not thick, but creamy, and paint that by the side of these lines, look at the difference. See what I mean? So that's the difference you get from when it's really watery. And that'll also be the difference you'll get if you find that your white paint is not opaque, or more semi-opaque or semi-transparent. Now, I've got a little video on mixing brown. I mentioned it earlier on. Have a look to the top right-hand corner there and give it a go. I'll see you there. Now, don't forget to click on subscribe, but also leave a comment down below and let me know your favourite top 10 colours. Which is your preference?